Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to this episode of Second Home. Today we are covering an event, the Gadget Free Zone, organized by the Indians in Kuwait and Indians women in Kuwait. Today's event is not only about keeping the children away from gadgets, but it is also about indulging them in various other creative games. As you can see behind me, children are playing games such as Brainita, Snakes and Ladders, Hopscotch, Hooplas, and so much more. All these games have the ability to enhance the cognitive skills of your child. Not just that, their interpersonal skills and their creative thinking skills, their critical analysis skills, the list goes on. So today, we have a sincere request to all you parents out there to take time and have some interactive time with your children and help them become better community members. One of our speakers for today's event is Mr. Crawford Wilson D'Souza. Other than what he's going to speak about today, let's also find out all the various other things that he does. Very interesting personality, very glad to bring to all of you, Mr. Crawford Wilson D'Souza. Welcome to our show.
Thank you, Amina.
Tell us about your speech today. What are you going to talk about? Is it for parents or for children?
It is more focused on children. The subject is mind power. More precisely, I'm going to talk about power of mind, power of subconscious mind. Very people rarely know that they have two minds, that is conscious mind and subconscious mind. It's like the story of Aladdin and the magical lamp, the genie. So a conscious mind is the Aladdin and the subconscious mind is the genie.
Excellent analogy, I loved it. Tell me more.
As you know, as the story goes, Aladdin rubbed the lamp. And every time he rubs that, what happens? The genie comes out and he says, your wish, my command. Okay, and whatever Aladdin asks from the genie supplies to him readily. That's how our life is.
I'm getting goosebumps just listening to it. That's how powerful your subconscious mind is. It's like a genie. It gives you everything you ask for.
Yeah.
And not just three wishes, right? I hope there's more.
It's enormous. Any number of wishes you can ask for. The story goes with only three wishes, but here, with any wish you want, your life wishes, you can, all your dreams and desires you can fulfill with your subconscious mind, which people are not aware of.
So for all those who are attending the seminar today, this is great. For those who are not been able to, could you give us a little tip on how do they start doing this? What is the secret of being able to rub that lamp? What should they start doing?
The rule is your subconscious mind or mind learns and understand the language of images. So what you should do is you should relax and dream about your wishes. You should have images in your mind, clear-cut images, as if you have already accomplished. And that is how the successful people are doing it. So whatever you fear, that also manifests. So why do you think negative thoughts? Change them to positive, because they are sure to manifest.
I mean, if positive thoughts manifest, then negative will do too. So all you viewers out there, be careful. Once you know you have the genie, it will also fulfill all the negative fears that you may have. So remove your fears. Great advice. Tell us, Wilson, why did you decide to, how did you come about this? And you're also a life coach, NLP, Neuro-Linguistic Programming Life Coach. Tell us more about that.
Basically, my life change is a paradigm shift. It was after the death of my sister. I started taking care of my life and lifestyle, living a positive life. And that is when the change started happening. Today, it's become my mission to share the secret with the world. And that is how I'm here sharing it with the kids. But I have also written a book called Life Management with Colors of Life. This Colors of Life is a theory which I have developed. What I noticed is today, people are living an imbalanced lifestyle. And this Colors of Life theory helped them balance their life. And then the subconscious mind works powerfully.
I was very intrigued by your color behind life management. I mean, we've heard of management tools and we've heard of so many different things to manage life. Colors is something very brand new for me. Tell us more.
Colors of life theory is basically a graphical representation of various areas of our life. It does happen in our life that we focus on one or two areas of our life. Then we find ourselves off balance in different areas of our lives. It's no doubt okay to focus in one or two areas, but taking it too far leads to stress and frustration in our life. That is the time you have to take a bird's-eye view of your life and you should balance it. Okay, that is actually the real secret of happiness. If people understand this, then they will know what is happiness. It's not about others, it's about you, it's internal.
Thank you so much, Wilson. This was so enlightening and I'd love to talk more to you, but our time's running short. Hopefully we'll catch up later. And if you have any message to your audience out today, go for it.
My message to our audience that I mentioned that we are all born with a purpose. So what is your purpose? Just find out in life and work towards it. And you'll live a happy and fulfilling life. Every day morning, you will get up with a purpose and to achieve it. And you'll go out there and start helping people. And that is what happiness is all about. It's not about you. It's all about helping others. So find your purpose and live your life with that purpose. And you'll be living a happy and fulfilling life. I can guarantee you.
Thank you, Wilson. Here's to a happy, healthy, fulfilling life. Thank you, Wilson. The other seminar we have in today's event is about parenting, and who does not need advice on that? I think all of us should take courses on parenting because it is what our children are going to become tomorrow, and they are our future generation. With us, we have Dr. Navneet Gandhi to share some tips on parenting and show us the path. Thank you so much for being with us, Doctor.
Thank you so much for having me here and for asking me my views on parenting. This is a topic which is very dear to me, and it has become more so in the past 3-4 years when I have been meeting a lot of parents and children with a lot of issues that they have been facing. And more than the course, I would say that although parenting is largely instinctive, but still there is a need to talk, there is a need to share. There could be a perspective which you could have, which could benefit me, and there could be a perspective which, if I share with you, you could benefit. So that is how I look at these opportunities, which are called seminars, just opportunities to talk, share, and discuss, so that our ideas and instincts on parenting could become more refined.
Your book, I just got a glimpse of the wonderful book, and it speaks about how children are different and that each child should be dealt differently. It's, you know, you have one child and you've raised him well and you feel like, oh wow, I've done the best. But then you have a second child and she's completely different. And that's one of the things that's very mind-boggling for a lot of parents. So what's your advice for such parents?
I think it is very important for parents to know and remember that there cannot be a specific list of do's and don'ts for anything and any relationship in life, and particularly for the parent-child relationship. So if my neighbor abuses the child or uses the harsher methods, that does not mean that the same will hold true for me. And I don't know if you've heard about DMIT, which is a new kind of multiple intelligence testing. So we have these DMIT tests these days in Kuwait. And as I was counseling the parents, I'm a trained counselor for those tests. So while counseling the parents, I came across a lot of issues which the parents said they were facing and the children said they were facing. So this book is a collection of those 30 situations which I have identified, which a large number of us are facing. Though your situations could be different than mine, but still there are certain common situations which I have presented in this book. So every chapter in the book is a situation. Like, for example, my younger daughter has started stealing. This is a situation. So on that situation, I have presented my perspective. That is how the book goes about. So there is no list of do this and don't do this. In a situation, this is one way of looking at things. That is what I have said, without sounding as if I'm giving a sermon or something. That's what I have
to. I'm really looking forward to reading the book. Thank you so much for your presenting it to me so gracefully. This is your seventh book, right?
Yes.
Oh, tell us about the first six. What were they about?
My first book was about the first lesson that I learned in life when I was a teenager, and that was that life is all about looking beyond what is very obvious. People may seem to be, situations may seem to be something, but you have to look beyond what is apparent or beyond what is obvious. Yes, and a couple of other books on how to look at life and relationships. I've just given my perspectives on how important it is to manage life and relationships. So 2-3 books were about that. And then there are 2 collections of short stories for children again. And then there's 1 collection of poetry. And
poetry. Wow. And in which language is that?
Hindi.
Wow. So not just master of all these different skills, but also languages now coming up.
I'm not a master, but then I've tried to pour my sentiments. And incidentally, it so happens that whenever I have to do something or write something on very serious issues, the words come out in English. But when I have to speak something from the heart, an emotional matter, so the words come out in Hindi. So all the poems are in Hindi, but prose is in English.
Very interesting. And Dr. Navneet Gandhi, so the doctor is because you've done PhD in?
National security and the changing dimensions of national security.
Oh, okay, wait, let me wrap my head around this. So you've written books on Hindi poetry, subjects for like children and relationships, and you're telling me you are a PhD in national
security.
I'm sure there must be some connection, but enlighten me. How does this come together?
Well, my primary interest when I was in school was to become the Prime Minister of the country. And so the focus was on politics all the way. And then when I graduated, the focus shifted a little from national politics to international politics. So I did my master's in international politics. Then I was selected as a Fulbright scholar by the American government to represent India and study their foreign policy. And over there, I started my PhD studies, and I completed the same in India. And I taught international politics for 12 years in the University of Mumbai.
Impressive, impressive. Please carry on, I'm listening.
So academically, my interest is in politics and international relations, and I write articles on the same. I have about 200, 250 articles published. And research papers, seminars. So that side of me is completely devoted to international relations. But I also feel, so obviously I don't just think. So when I think on world politics. When I feel largely on children and relationships and life. So I pour out my ideas in books on them.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for talking to us and introducing us to your thoughts and to your feelings, because really it's a very interesting way of understanding yourself and where you are in your life. And we were just talking to Wilson, and he was talking about attracting things and that you have to visualize. And I have to tell Wilson that sometimes when you attract and visualize some things, you end up getting better.
Yes.
I mean, because here you are wanting to be the Prime Minister, but really what you've achieved is so much more than what, you know.
Nice.
Seriously, thank you so much for talking to us and sharing this.
Thank you so much, and I wish and hope that we meet again and that we continue this conversation further.
Sure, but we are not going to let you go without you giving us a word of advice for all our parents out there who are listening to you today. What is the single most important tip you think you can give to our parents today?
Although I must give a disclaimer in the beginning that there are no ready-made formulae for parenting and there cannot be a handbook or tips. But my personal perspective is that if we could just take care of 4 issues or areas. One is we need to take care of their tender bodies, which means that no to shortcuts, and shortcuts in terms of giving them packaged and processed food. That is one of my chief pleas or pleading to the parents. And second is we have to take care of their minds. Their minds need to be sharp rather than dull. And that is the reason why they need to be away from gadgets till the age of 13. So I very much request and again plead to the parents that please, at least till the age of 13, keep them away from screens. Let their eyes look at the sky and conceive poetry. You know, let the writers and the poets and the creative artists in them take birth and let them come out. And because if they remain glued to the mechanical screens, the cold screens, they are just receiving the information. The communication is one way. They are being bombarded with colorful and multimedia messages. But they are not able to, the messages or the replies or, you know, no creativity is coming out of them in the return process. Whereas when you look at the sky for some time, you feel like a poetry is coming out of you. But you don't feel anything when you look at the screens and the very attractively made videos.
They tell you what you should feel. Because that's what screens do. They direct and then you feel like that. But what about your own inner feeling?
And they make the screens and the baby videos and all of these things so very attractive that thereafter the child does not even want to look at the mundane textbooks, which are in black and white and no good pictures and no good sounds. And they search for where to switch the textbook on because they are so used to.
So true. So we have the body in place. Great advice there. Because, you know, there are books that says you are what you eat. So it's very important what you're putting in your children's mouth. And the second is the mind. Yes. And the third advice is?
The third advice is that whenever parents feel that why are their children, let's say, having issues or having bad habits, or why are they a little self-centered, or why are they sometimes not so very contented in life? I feel that parents can get all the answers to all of these issues if they just hold a mirror and look at themselves. Because no child grows up in a vacuum. They are our children. They will be like us. If they have seen words of ingratitude in the house, if they have seen behavior or conduct which is self-centered with others, like you and I may play games in politics, they will play games with us. I mean, in offices we might play games, they could play games at home. So the point is that it is very important to keep cleansing ourselves so that their conduct is reflected very clearly in the mirror. And at the last, I would like to say that one area where I fear the most for our kids in the future is their social skills. They are so much looking at the screen all the time that the day they look up, they are going to find themselves all alone in a dark room, because they will have limited number of siblings. They will have limited number of first and second cousins. And we are not teaching them the importance of speaking up to people. Just like, I've just met you and I already, you know, I feel like meeting you again. I feel like sitting with a cup of tea and, you know, chatting with you and going on and on. So the point is, if you look at airports, malls, children are glued to the screen. They are not talking to anybody. They cannot engage in a conversation with strangers for about 5 minutes. They know how to switch on the YouTube at the age of 3, but they cannot speak 3 lines with a stranger that, how are you? How is your health? How are you doing? So their social skills, because if they have shoulders to lean on, and hands to hold, they will not be alone. And suicidal tendencies, pressures, competitions, you know, they'll take it and they're
screaming because they're feeling lonely and isolated.
And they'll be able to take the, see, competition we cannot wish away now. But they'll be able to take that competition in their stride if they know that I have shoulders to lean on. I have to become a shoulder so that others can lean on me. And I have hands to hold. I have friends. I have cousins. So let us fill their minds with hope that relationships are the key to balance and the key to contentment in life. So let us not leave this world by keeping fixed deposits and mutual funds for them. Let us leave this world by entrusting at least 6-7 good relationships all around them so that they stay safe even after we are not there.
Beautiful, beautiful, Dr. Navneet Gandhi. Well said. Excellent advice. I'm full of hope now just listening to you for our future generations. And if every parent can take this up for their child to wanting to raise children like that, because they are the future, we will all be seeing some great future together. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It's now time to introduce to all of you a new organization, Indian Women in Kuwait, and their founding members. Welcome to our show. We know Dr. Navneet Gandhi. We just met her and we've seen her multiple talents. There is Deepika. We have Parinita and Helen. And there's Reshmi, who isn't here at the moment, present with us. We are all thinking of you, Reshmi. But tell us about this organization, Indians Women in Kuwait. When was this first founded, Deepika?
See, Indian Women in Kuwait was founded in the year 2012. And it's been founded for the mayor, for the Indian women community over here in Kuwait. We are doing info entertainment programs exclusively for the women community. We have done a lot of events in these few years. We have done events like Dubai Darshan, Kuwait Darshan.
Wait a minute, Darshan, what is that?
Kuwait Darshan is nothing but a half-day tour to show them Kuwait. There are a lot of women who are not seen Kuwait properly. So we show them Kuwait, we tell them the history of Kuwait. We have a guide who takes them around Kuwait and show them so that they know what are the places are there in Kuwait.
And this guide is Indian?
The guide is here only. Dr. Navneet is the guide.
That's very interesting concept. I've never really thought of that because we've lived in Kuwait all our lives. It never occurred to me that, you know, someone who's new to Kuwait would have not seen it and that you arrange these visits for these women. It's very interesting. Tell us more.
See, actually, there are women who have not come out of their houses only to see the places, because when we show them the places, they are seeing it for the first time. They were very excited. They were very happy to know that there are places like this. So this is almost, we have done it around 3 to 4 times. Kuwait Darshan almost happens every year.
And you have a group of women at the same time?
Yeah, we as a team, we take we'll be having around 50 women who will be taken in one single bus.
Oh, wow, 50 women. Wait a minute, I have to ask you this question. Is dealing with 50 women easier than dealing with 50 children? Or is it the same or it's easier?
It's easy.
I cannot imagine 50 women in a bus. How do you handle that?
It is easy. We have got used to it. We have done it.
Okay, but tell me, how do you get them? How do you advertise like this is going to happen? Where do people know that you're going to do next events?
See, Indian Women in Kuwait is actually associated with IIK. So whatever we do it advertised in Indians in Kuwait. We come under Indians in Kuwait. Oh,
okay. And today's event, I think, is a genius idea. Getting children a gadget-free zone. Wow, brilliant. And I'm loving what I'm seeing here. You guys, you have to see this to believe it. All the children have been here with absolutely no screens. I can see a lot of board games. There's Brainita and all those board games that I grew up with. I mean, these are very intelligent games and I'm very happy to see it. Tell us more about today's event and how did you come up with this idea?
As you said, we have seen that a lot of children are here with full of only playing with gadgets and they don't come out of their houses to play games. So as children, we have never been with gadgets and we have played games. So we thought we'll introduce them these traditional games, what we have played to the kids, so that they know that other than gadgets, there are a lot of other games to play. So they don't need to be in gadgets. They can come out of it, be free of it and play. That's the reason why we have the title itself, Freedom from Gadgets. So we have tried to introduce as many games as much as we can, mainly the traditional games that we have played as children. So what we have seen right now is this is the second time we are having this particular event. We have had this event in Salmiya and we saw the success of the event. We have seen how children have enjoyed the event. Even actually, if you see, other than the children, even the parents play the games because they remember those games. They're more excited to play those games. So and now they are telling that they will go home and they will play these games with the kids. So seeing that, we thought we'll have one more time in Fahil. And you can see the success already.
Absolutely. Tell us more about other upcoming events that you have.
See, next we are coming up with Diwali Mela, where IVIC team will be organizing a lot of competitions, Diwali-related competitions in Diwali Mela. And that is happening in October 18th.
Looking forward to that as well. But really, thank you so much for what you do as Indian Women in Kuwait. I think you filled a void that was much needed to be filled. And I think you're doing great work. So thank you so much for that. I'm also going to go and play some games now. So come along. It's now time to meet the Indians in Kuwait team. They've organized today's event in collaboration with the Indians Women in Kuwait. Let's find out more about the team members. I have with us Morgan D'Souza, Sunoj Nambiar, and George Matthew. Welcome to our show.
Hi.
Listen, I got a lot to know about today's event from the Indians Women in Kuwait, and I'm really enjoying today's event because of the gadget-free zone and what the children are doing here. But tell us, this is not the first one, right? You had one in Salmiya earlier.
Yes, this is the second time we're having it this year. The first time we did it in March, at the end of March. It's just a new concept that we've started off for the new children because they're all stuck to their phones, they're stuck to their TVs. It's just something that to bring them out of them, bringing them out of the houses and teach them things that we've played when we were kids and our parents have played when we were kids.
You know, you're still a kid, so I don't think you get a chance to say that.
I don't think so, but that's a compliment.
Listen, do you get feedback from the children saying, I want to play this game, or do you get some those kind of feedback?
You know, it's very good to see their interest in all these new things because they've never seen things like this before. And when they're coming up to us, they are very excited. They're like, okay, we want to see this, we want to play this, we want to learn this. And it's great to see that.
I know, interesting you bring that because just a couple of days ago, my son came across an audio cassette. You know, the ones that we used to
reel. Yes.
And he's like, Mom, what is this? And I'm like, oh, wow, this is such a new generation.
I haven't seen any of that kind of things right now.
True. But we are also looking forward to the upcoming event. The Diwali Mela is also something everyone looks forward to because it's been a great success over the past couple of years. So what's new this time in Diwali Mela? And I know there's a lot to do, but...
There's always something new happening at Diwali Mela, but this is the biggest event that we always organize throughout the year. And we always wait for it because it's a huge gathering for all our Indian communities. And it's just a full fun day event, even for the entire family also.
What other events do you hold other than these two?
So apart from that, we also have a cultural event for associations. Plus we have reporter programs for young reporters who are interested in writing and speeches and all of that kind of things as well. So it's not only the kids that we're targeting, but we are also keeping in the parents involved in the programs that we have.
Right. And you have something for the youth as well?
Yes, the young reporter program as well. Yeah, that's something that they do. That they can write articles for the website. We'll publish them if they're good enough. And then that's how they get recognition from it.
That's very interesting because you you know, you help give them a platform to explore their ability, their writing ability at that age, which is very much needed for children today. And tell us about any other events that you're going to host.
As of now, these two are planned. Then we have something called as a travel expo that we do. So they are just options that we are putting out there for everyone to come get interested in the activities that we're doing because IAK is not only just the website. We also would like to get involved with our community. That's why we come in front so that y'all can get involved with us as well.
I like that. He's speaking like a true marketing person here.
Yeah.
So let's throw that into. If we want to reach out to what your next events are, where does our audience go, log into?
You log into www.indiansinkuwait.com. We'll see you there.
We'll see you there.
See you there.
Thank you. This is all we had for today's episode. I hope today's shows allowed you to take a few pointers by the speech given by Dr. Navneet Gandhi, where she spoke on parenting skills. Parenting is probably one of the most important things we do in our lives. And speaking to her reminded me of something that I always say for a mother. Wo kehte hain ki sakht raahon mein bhi aasan safar lagta hai. Ye meri maa ki duaon ka asar lagta hai. This is what a mother is to everybody. And as parents, it is our duty to raise them well. We also had a speech by Dr. Crawford Wilson, who told us about the power of our subconscious mind. Very important again. To all our parents out here from this show today, I encourage all of you to give your children a gadget-free time. Until next week, from the team of Kuwait TV2, stay blessed.